It is Friday afternoon, and I don't know about you, but I'm damn sick and tired of talking politics. I'm tired of all of it. I'm tired of being angry. So we're going to change the tone here. I told you we have a special guest today, and we're going to go back a few years. I first got to say, before I bring on Mark, that, you know, I only was with Mark and Brian for 4 years, but they were probably four of the most consequential years of my life. I always considered these guys like my brothers. They were with me through some really rough times. I was with them through some great times. And years went by. And now today, I look at the date. It's June 11th, 2021. 30 years ago, June 11th, 1991, I was producing the Mark and Brian Show. And I think at that time, it was the number one morning show in Los Angeles radio. And just this past year, Mark and Brian were inducted into the Radio Hall of Fame. And it was long overdue, an honor much deserved. And I feel great to be able to say congratulations in person to Mark Thompson. Hey, buddy.
How are you? And thank you.
I'm old, hanging in there, but old.
You know, it's a fact of life. I was thinking about this just the other day. I've got two grandchildren due. I got one in August and one in October. And those of you that are young and haven't gone through this, it happens so quickly. Right. And it doesn't matter how many people say it to you. Nope. When you're young, and how many times you hear it and you don't believe it. I'm telling you, it is the blink of an eye. And all of a sudden, I'm an old guy. But it is what it is. And I can also say that I'm lucky in that physically, I still feel really good. Mentally, I still have certain capacity. And so the age thing doesn't mean a great deal to me. 65, I feel strong. I have recently written down a couple of things in thinking that I used to have a fear in that I would be sitting on my porch at 80 in my rocking chair, and I would be looking back with regret that if I had done this, if I had done that differently, that I could have made it. I don't have that fear.
Well, because you made it, you know, you did make it.
I did. And I'm very proud of that because I came from a really, really small town of Muscle Shoals, Alabama, and I climbed the ladder of radio because that was my dream, to make it to major market and to be one of the best that I could possibly be. Mm-hmm. And to have done that and accomplished that is a huge feeling of pride and proudness for me.
Absolutely. And you should. And so, you know, it's funny, I have listeners to this show, which is mostly politics, but, you know, insanity too. I learned a lot from you guys. But we have a listener in the regular in the NicoleSandler.com chat room named Proudskell, who I know lives in Alabama. And before the show started, there he was in the chat room. And I asked him, I said, hey, do you remember Mark and Brian from Alabama? And he said, yes, they left my sophomore year of college from Birmingham to Los Angeles. So wow. Proud School's there. And I said, well, okay, cool. Well, Mark's coming on today. He's like, oh, cool. You know, this is, and I've shared other things with you. There's a guy, his name is Zach Timpson, I think. And he does like song parodies on YouTube. He's very creative. He's really good. And he grew up on Mark and Brian. And his dad used to listen when he was a little kid. And he's like, oh, I remember you from when I was just a kid. And we'd listen to Mark. And because his father was so into the show, he got into it. And now he's, you know, he does these videos. He's going to be on Broadway one day. Do you ever sit back and realize the impact that you've had on lives throughout the years, now that so many years have gone by?
I think that that I do realize there were a lot of people who enjoyed what we were doing, primarily in the first five years. Mm-hmm. In fact, when I went into the Hall of Fame, I was talking with the director, the president of the Radio Hall of Fame, and he confirmed to me that you're going into the Hall of Fame not for the 27 years, but for the first five. Wow. And you were there for that, Nicole. We were doing, and we didn't mean to. We weren't aware of what we were doing, but we were creating a brand new kind of morning radio that only because nobody had done what we were doing before.
You're right.
We were the ones that went in and dethroned Rick Dees.
Yes,
and Rick was
Rick
was the best. He was the king of one-liner radio. He had the best writers, the best voice actors. He was the very best.
Mm-hmm.
But Rick had been on for 8 years, and just like anybody in entertainment, you know, if you're lucky enough to have your 15 minutes, enjoy it while you're there. But people do get used to it and they move on to the next pretty face. And we came in and we were a 180 of what Rick was doing. And it was one of the reasons we were able to win, because we didn't play him at his game.
That's right.
We did something completely different, completely new. And really, honestly, what we were doing was exactly precisely whatever we wanted to be doing at that minute. If it seemed funny to us, we did it. And we were kind of in that Beatles phase where when they released that piece of shit Revolution.
Number nine.
Yeah, I mean, what a piece of garbage. And everybody said it was genius.
Well,
it felt to me, it didn't matter what we did at that time, it was working. And then, of course, later, years down the road, it didn't matter what we did. Nothing worked. So it's just a testament to we were at the right place at the right time and enjoying every moment. I can tell you without qualification, I couldn't wait to get to the radio station and start another 4 hours of that insane, wonderful, joyous, creative time.
Well, me too. And that's the thing. You know, I wasn't there. I came to LA right around the same time you did. I moved out from New York. You and Brian came out from Alabama. And I was working at, I think at the time I was at, it had been KNX-FM, and then it turned to KODJ Oldies, and I was the promotion director. But I was listening to what you guys were doing, and I was just, I said, these guys are doing something so different, so creative. This is so good. I got to work with them. Do you remember how we met?
I don't, but
I will. Let me refresh you. Disneyland? Please. Disneyland? You don't remember. We were at Disneyland. We didn't know each other then. I happened to be at Disneyland. You were there with your wife, Linda, with Matthew and Amy. Katie was not yet born. They were in the strollers, and I saw you, and I'm like, I got to do it. I just got to do it. I got to do it. I went up to you, and I said, hi, Mark. You don't know me, but I hope you will soon. I'm Nicole Sandler. I came from New York. I produced the Jim Kerr Morning Show at WPLJ. I'm working over at KODJ now. I need to be your producer. And that's how we started talking.
Wow.
Yes.
Well, I have to tell you, Nicole was with us in the white hot days where this woman as our producer would get 1,000 phone calls a day for, you know, because when you have heat, you know, you have heat and everybody wants a piece of that. And Nicole was having to filter through all of that. I don't even know how to begin to think that one person could do that job.
And think about this, Mark. It was 1990 when I joined you. It was June or July of 1990. We had no computers. The computers, in fact, were delivered to KLOS the day I left in 94. As I was leaving, the computers were being brought in. So I did all this without email, and we didn't even have cell phones yet, because cell phones were around, but they were, you know, you had a cell phone. I didn't. You know, so this was regular old voicemail on a regular dial-up phone, because it was the olden days. We didn't have digital stuff. We would record stuff on reel-to-reel and use a razor blade and an editing block and splicing tape, right? That's what we did. So, so things were even more complicated. And we didn't have assistants. For the longest time, we had a couple of interns, but it was us. And you guys, again, were doing something so different, and I guess you heard something in me. We started talking. It probably took 6 months from the time we first met until they finally brought me on. And then it was just, you know what? Like I said at the beginning, you guys are like my brothers. And we went through a lot. I'm sure you remember. It was maybe, I want to say like 92. So a couple of years into it, I was supposed to go see Paul Simon in concert, and I was taking Kevin Gilbert with me. We were going to go together. And I got a phone call. My father had had an accident. You remember this?
I do.
My father was pushed, had an accident, quadriplegic. And so I'm flying back and forth between LA and Miami dealing with my dad. And you guys couldn't have been, you know, more accommodating and better because we really were a family.
Yeah, I you know, that's one of the things that we all experience whenever we're working, especially at a very high level. Real life doesn't stop, even though your career demands everything that you've got. And then some. Real life will come in and knock on your door. And I think everybody has to be understanding of when those things happen and when they come up, because it has to be dealt with. And just like yourself, when I was losing my immediate family, they were 3,000 miles across the country. And, you know, you start dealing with someone, like you said, your dad, a quadriplegic, and there you are in LA and he's in Florida. It's an almost impossible scenario, but yet you do it. And that's just what real life is. It has to be dealt with.
You know, we dealt with serious stuff because we had these life events. I remember, you know, Linda taking the pregnancy test on the air for Katie and hitting the Marcone song, Things We've Handed Down, when we found out and the tears are running. You had your vasectomy live on the air. I mean, every part of our lives really were laid open. And I think that's one of the reasons why the show was so successful, is because we had no secrets. Everything that we talked about, and we talked about everything, was fodder. And, you know, one of the moments I'll always remember, and I'm sure you remember it too, is a discussion we had. And I thought we were talking, you and me, before we went on the air. We went on the air at 6, but we'd be sitting in the studio before. And you'd say, how was your weekend? And I said, well, I took home those Sleeping Beauty books. You know where I'm going with this. The Anne Rice Sleeping Beauty books?
Oh, sure, sure, yeah.
So Anne Rice, at the time, was very hot with Interview with a Vampire and all that, and somebody had sent us this box set. She had written, under a pseudonym, A.N. Rockwellaire, The Claiming of Sleeping Beauty, and then there were two others. It was a trilogy. And it was very much adult erotica. And I was telling you the story about, I took one of the books on the beach because I lived right at the beach, and I was lying on the beach, and I guess I, between the book and the mound of sand beneath me, I had a kind of a physical reaction. Well, oh my God, look on the screen. This is the from the Los Angeles Times. I got to put it up on that screen. Los Angeles Times bestseller list. From, what was the date here? It was 19, I can't read, it's too little because my eyes are too bad.
But I can't see.
Yeah, it's number 4 book, The Claiming of Sleeping Beauty by Anne Rockwellaire. A book that had been, it was at least 10 years old, and it gets on the LA Times bestseller list. And it was an obscure book that nobody had ever heard of. And because of this discussion we had on the air, that book goes on the bestseller list, and Anne Rice came on the show. Did a wonderful interview with you guys. That's the kind of power that radio had back then. I don't think it has it anymore because everything's so fragmented.
Yeah. Sadly, we were both in radio when it was great, but radio went through a change. February 8th, 1996, Bill Clinton signed the Telecommunications Act.
Yes, he did.
And basically, there was a lot of stuff in there, as most of those things do. But what it did was two things that were damaging to the radio that I loved. It basically, the two things it said, first and foremost, any individual or company can go and buy as many radio stations as they would like. And two, the real damaging one, any individual or business company can go into one city and buy up to eight
radio stations. Yeah.
And that means that corporate, who had endless amounts of money and what they didn't have, they could borrow, not only bought their radio station, but they bought their competition, and it made it a very, and they found a much cheaper way to put out local radio, as opposed to what I fell in love with, which was personality driven radio.
Right.
You know, because if you listen to a top 40 station or a classic rock, there's a competitor. Both of them play the same commercials, the same promotions, the right. same songs.
Right.
The only thing that differentiates the two was the personalities. And it was that that I fell in love with. And it was that that I wanted to become. And sadly, those the needs of the high profile personalities are no longer there. And everything that I built myself into became, you know, the phone doesn't ring anymore. And I'm not complaining. I was there when it was great.
That's right.
And I'm fortunate and lucky to have been there and enjoyed every moment of it. But I miss it and I loved it so very much. And it's like everything, it changes.
Yeah, it does. And it's changed so much. And I, too, and my listeners can tell you, I rail against that 1996 Telecommunications Act to this day. And in fact, it was just last month, the Supreme Court unanimously upheld the loosening of ownership rules. In fact, they loosened them up even more. So now that one company that could own 8 radio stations can also own 2 or 3 TV stations and a couple of newspapers in the same market, too. The liberals, you know, Sotomayor and Kagan vote, we're in line with this. And I'm like, oh my God, they have totally destroyed the industry that I grew up with, that I grew up in and loved.
Well, sadly, and I don't think there's many people who could disagree with this statement. Let's say you open a donut shop mm-hmm. and your competitor is right down the street and they too were making donuts. And what made the world great and made it wonderful for all of us is that if you, as an owner of a donut shop, if you want to be competitive and make a living, you've got to make the best donuts in the world.
That's right.
Yours have to be fresher, mm-hmm. better, bigger, less expensive than your competitor. And that's what made the world go round. And this Telecommunications Act kind of took that out of the balance, because not only do they own your donut shop, mm-hmm. they bought that one down there. So they can serve you any donut. Doesn't matter. You're going to buy it because there's no other donut in town.
That's right. That's right. And yeah. And people don't have to work as hard as we did. Or really, they skate easier now because there are so many different outlets and everything, like I said, is so fragmented. But, you know, I go back to how you said it. This show was white hot. I was there. You started, what, in 88, I think? I joined
87.
Okay, I joined in 90. I was there in 94. And during that time, you know, we beat Rick Dees and number one. And everywhere you went, I mean, it was Mark and Brian. Because it was radio. There was no internet then. This was where you'd go, and LA is such a car town. But part of why I think you guys were so successful is you were honest. When you said it was what made us laugh, it was what was funny. I always described you as two overgrown kids who get to play out your silliest fantasies. So, for instance, down the street that we were on La Cienega Boulevard, right in LA, Culver City now. If you go up just the other side of the 10 freeway, there was a Bob's Big Boy restaurant.
Sure.
And one of you, you used to call it Shoney's, because I guess in Alabama it was Shoney's, but in LA it was Bob's. And yeah. One of you noticed that the Bob's Big Boy statue, excuse me, looked an awful lot like Elvis Presley, who happened to be a character on the show. Elvis made regular appearances and would burp and sing and do things. So one day we took our convertible Cadillac, that was their car. You had your special cell phone pack. This thing was enormous. It was like a remote broadcast thing that the engineers had built so you guys could go out in the car and broadcast. And this was the early days of cell phone radios. And they built this giant contraption. You got in the car, drove to the Bob's Big Boy, hijacked the statue out of the front yard, took it back to the station, and we transformed it into Elvis Bob. Now, people might be wondering why nobody was arrested or anything, because what they didn't know is behind the scenes, I cleared it with the restaurant and said, you're going to come and take that statue, and it's going to give them tons of publicity, and they went along with it for whatever reason. So, we always drew on the talents of our listeners. They were part of the family. And mm-hmm. there was a guy named Art, I believe, who was sure. tasked with housing the Elvis Bob, the Bob, mm-hmm. and turning mm-hmm. him into the Elvis Bob. And so here is the Elvis Bob.
Oh, sure it is.
That is Elvis Bob. And Elvis Bob became all kinds of different things. Like, we would do the Halloween drive-ins, and one year he was Frankenbob, and one year Dracubob. You know, Brian was a skydiver. So we went out to California City and threw the Elvis Bob in a parachute out of an airplane, and thousands of people came out there. Or maybe it was Lake Elsinore. I it's a long time ago. I get mixed
up.
Well,
my other favorite is we went to Vegas and we catapulted the Elvis Bob over the fountains.
Well, we did. And funny you should bring that up. So Caesar's Palace. Here's the marquee. It says Caesar's Palace, Mark and Brian. The next one says Evil Bob, because we transformed him into Evil Bob. Evil Knievel was there. Tom Jones was there. And then the third screen says Jumps the Fountains. And then here's a shot of Evil Bob in mid-catapult over the fountains at Caesar's Palace. Because it was there, because it was silly and it was fun. And you see how many people we had there? The guy, I don't know if you remember this, but one of the guys from Caesar's Palace came on the air and he said, we have more people here for the jumping of Evil Bob across the fountain than we did for Evil Knievel's jump across the fountains.
Yeah, I mean, that's a prime example of the stupid crap we were doing. We did it because we wanted to see it. We did it because it was stupid and because it could be done. And, you know, we were very clear about our love of David Letterman and Steve Martin. And, you know, David, up until the day he left, he did the dumbest things. Like, one of them I loved is Jay Thomas was a big legendary guest of David. And David did this dumb thing. Every Christmas, Jay Thomas would come back on the show. There was a Christmas tree set up with a giant meatball connected to the top of it. And Jay and David would take turns throwing NFL footballs at the meatball, and the one to knock it off was the king. Right. Why does it exist? It doesn't need to, but it was mesmerizing to watch.
Right.
The very same thing. David showed me that there was a place for stupid crap on the air.
Oh yeah.
And we celebrated that daily.
Without a doubt. You know, one more Elvis Bob thing, because this was my favorite and one of my moments that I will never ever forget because it was just so epic. Elvis Presley was on RCA Records, but that didn't matter because in LA we had the iconic Capitol Records building. And so I don't know who brought it up. I don't know where it came from, but one of you guys decided Elvis always wanted to be on Capitol Records. Wouldn't it be great if we could take the Elvis Bob and put him on top of the Capitol Records building? That is a photo of the Elvis Bob on top of the Capitol Records building. And, you know, the guy at the time, the president of Capitol Records, was a man named Joe Smith, who my father went to college with a million years ago. And I called him and I said, I don't know if, you know, I'm Willie Sandler's daughter. And he remembered and we talked and I pitched him on the idea. He said, let's do it. And we did the whole thing live on the air. We had to get it up the elevator in the Capitol Records building. And then the final part was stairs and he wouldn't fit. So someone brought a Sawzall or something like that and sawed off the base. And the whole thing unfolded live on the air. This was the kind of shit. And people would get to work and wouldn't want to turn off the radio because they had to hear how it came. And then the Elvis Bob sat atop the Capitol Records building, I think, for about a week. And you could see it from the 101 freeway driving down, you know, the Hollywood freeway. And there it was. It was epic. That's kind of stuff that, you know, you couldn't make up.
No, you couldn't. And why would you? But it was exactly what we did each and every day. It was exhausting and wonderful at the absolute same time. Stupid shit, stupid crap. We were known for it. We did it each and every day that we were alive and could. And Nicole just ran you through some of the dumber. So yeah, right there he is.
Yeah, but there was also some other like epic stuff. We got big name guests on the show because, you know, number one morning show in Los Angeles. So do you remember the Pete Townsend appearance?
I do. Pete came in and was sitting in there and we had arranged it for it to be the largest guitar jam in the world.
That's right.
And we had a moment where Pete sat down and he had asked his handler, I don't remember the person's name.
It was Danny Bush from Atlantic Records.
Well, Danny was in trouble because Pete looked and asked why the crowd was out there.
He had no idea.
Yeah, he didn't. He didn't know that it was happening. And so we had to tell him, well, we thought we cleared it, but everybody came to do a jam with you on the guitar. And luckily for us, Pete was in a pretty good mood and he agreed to do it, to go out. And so, as you can see, everybody in the audience had a guitar and Pete Townsend jammed with them.
They played Pinball Wizard and it was the world's largest guitar off. So you can tell your grandchildren that you played guitar with Pete Townsend.
And I when it was over, this guy, this is right before we left there and came back into the building, this guy came up to Pete and he had this beautiful Yamaha, a gorgeous guitar. And he hands it to Pete and he said, if you would do me the favor, if you would please smash it and then sign it. And Pete, I mean, this is Pete Townsend.
Yes.
I mean, I took my son to the Hollywood Bowl to see The Who, and I got an erection when Pete slammed his guitar to the stage. But Pete took this gorgeous guitar and he looked at the guy and he goes, are you certain you want me? This is a
beautiful. I remember that like it was yesterday. Right.
And he said, absolutely, man, it would be my honor. So Pete smashed it into pieces and signed it. And the guy, I think, cried.
Yeah.
So it was just that kind of crap. Again, we were hanging by a thread there because Pete could have easily said, I'm not doing it, not in the mood, didn't know about it, I'm out. But he didn't.
Right.
I remember he looked at both of us and he said, it's okay. I'll do it. It's fine.
Yeah.
And we were all like, Jesus, thank God.
Right. And we had to get the music for Pinball Wizard because that's what the song we arranged that everyone was going to play. And he was totally unaware of it. Yeah, I'll have to give Danny Bush shit about that next time I see him on Facebook, because all us old folks are still kicking around out here. But, you know, as silly as the things we did, we also did some serious stuff. In fact, on the eve of the first Gulf War, we went to Saudi Arabia, teamed up with the USO and MGM Grand Air. And that was one of the most emotional things I've ever been through.
Yeah, it was also unique in that we jumped on the USO's airplane. They were flying over with half of the airplane was stuff for the soldiers. And we kind of piggybacked on that. And I remember we landed in Switzerland to get gas and we were told if we got off the airplane, we wouldn't be allowed back on, which of course means we got off the airplane.
It was actually Scotland, but yes, you're right.
Scotland.
Prescott and Airport.
We got back on.
Yes, we did.
And I remember it was intense in that we were allowed to be on the ground for exactly 4 hours.
Yeah.
Do your show
and get back on the airplane.
Yeah. And so it was a quick turnaround, and I did something that I found to be brilliant. Because it was such a fast turn, I wore my watch, which I never did, but I took my watch. And when the rest of the airplane would sleep, I was awake.
Huh.
I kept myself on the sleep schedule of California so that when I landed, I was still good to go.
Mm-hmm.
So while you guys slept, I was awake. While I slept, you were awake.
Right. You know, I kept a journal on that trip, and it was, you know, packed away. Years later, I found it. It was like the 25th anniversary of the war or something. And I pulled it out and posted it again. And I read it. It brings me to tears. But that was the kind of shit that we did. And it wasn't just a goofy show. That was talking to soldiers who were, you know, stationed out there. And it was before the holidays. It was Christmas time. And we would connect them with their families back home. And there wasn't a dry eye anywhere. That day. And it was just so leaving, you know, closing the door to the plane and leaving those young men there was just heartbreaking. It was just horrible.
It was. And that was, you know, I'm glad you documented that because that was, I think, the end of 91.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so.
That year for us, we were doing The Adventures of Mark and Brian.
That's right.
So we were filming. We would finish the show at 10, jump in a van, go shoot TV, climb in bed at 11, get up and do it again. So it was an exhausting year. And that was certainly a unique and very powerful way of saying goodbye to that very powerful year.
Yeah, it was. And then, but it wasn't over yet, because we came back and we had already, I believe, done your birthday show, because we would do these ridiculous birthday shows twice a year for you in December and for Brian in May that were just over the top crazy. I was looking at video of one that I do. I have all kinds of stuff here where you, for whatever reason, really liked the Marty Robbins song El Paso. Mm. So we recreated the Rose's Cantina and acted it out and had horses come in. And one year we had the you're a big Andy Griffith fan. Our listeners built the Andy Griffith Show jailhouse in the Fun Zone, our parking lot, which we call the Fun mm-hmm. Zone. And we had Don Knotts come in. I mean, it was just a magical show. And at the end of the show, I think we put you in a car to go meet Andy for the first time. So
yeah. I went to the set of Matlock. Uh-huh. I think you tried to get Andy to come down. He couldn't because he was shooting.
Yep.
But I met Andy, of all things. I was taken to the makeup room, and there he was, and I met him, and I had a chance to explain to him how much he meant. And, of course, he hears that from everybody. But as we were meeting and talking, his makeup artist was trimming his eyebrows with scissors. of all things, because you know, you get old and you've got bushy hair up there, and but he could not have been more gracious or wonderful, and that was a unique and special, wonderful moment. And so if I haven't said thank you already,
I'm laughing because I could just picture you with what you're thinking with the eyebrow, thinking, all right, can I get a couple of the clippings, and there's a bit in here somewhere. Because everything became a bit. Seriously, yeah. Everything became a bit.
Well, it was that was a big, big year and very special to meet Andy, because, you know, even to this day, in fact, you'll enjoy this. I met on the program. I met Luke Perry.
Right.
And when it was first presented to me about Luke being on the show, I was very busy in the 90s and I didn't see Beverly Hills 90210. Oh, wow. Plus, I mean, it wasn't my bag. It's not the kind of show I'd see, but I was told that Luke would be somebody we should have on the show. So I agreed. He came in, I fell in love with him. And he and I were big buddies. And one of the main things we had in common was the Andy Griffith Show. Huh. He was as big a fan as I was. Oh. And we would do a thing where we would go for months and not speak. And then most of our communication was text. He would text me a line from the Andy Griffith Show. And the game was to text back the very next line that comes from that moment.
Oh, wow.
And neither he or I ever missed one.
Wow.
And normally it would be months. And our normal communication was real simple. Instead of calling and saying, hey, our communication was, I would get a text from Luke and it would be, Goober says, hey, and the proper response is, hey to Goober. And that would be it. And that would be all we would have. So, sadly we lost Luke, and it was such a shocking and saddening, way for it to go. But yeah, the Andy Griffith Show still to this day, a massive part of my life.
Oh, without a doubt. And of course, it's synonymous with you. And you know, one other thing is KLOS was a big rock station in Los Angeles. You and Brian were not exactly the rock aficionados. I think the station in Birmingham was top 40, right?
Yes. Yes, it was. And I spent my entire life in top 40.
Right. So you really didn't know the music, and it didn't matter because we would play anything and everything. We had musical guests on we mentioned Pete Townsend. We had Crowded House. We had Lyle Lovett. We had
Barry Manilow.
Barry Manilow was a friend of the show. He did the Christmas show one year, which was awesome. You know, people that you would not expect came on. And again, because it was a thing where, you know what, we're gonna end on the Progressive Voices Network in just a moment. So I'm going to say goodbye to our friends at Progressive Voices. Thank you for listening. You can come over to NicoleSandler.com or Facebook or YouTube or Twitter or Twitch and keep listening, because I'm going to keep Mark for a few more minutes. But have a great weekend, everyone. We'll see you Monday. All right, so they're gone. Now we can really talk. Because everyone was listening, one of my favorite bits on the show, and I think you'll remember this one too, because I think it's when you first met him. you and Brian used to play, you know, we did silly things, and you did a game, who would you rather be? And you would, you know, would you rather be Sly Stallone or Kurt Russell? Would you rather be whoever? And it was always Kurt Russell. It always came down to Kurt Russell. And we wanted to get Kurt Russell on the show and couldn't. And somehow, I think his driver called in one day, and I was talking to him, and we set up a thing. And I told him, at what time is Kurt going to be in the car? And he said, well, we're driving to the studio at whatever time. And I said, all right, be listening, because Mark and Brian will do the who would you rather be bit. If you can have him listening, maybe he'll call in. Here's the hotline number. And sure enough, he did. In fact, well, let's listen.
We're going to be there.
I'm going to be there, too.
Cam and Tamara.
That'd be your hometown.
That's my hometown.
So what can we help you with?
Well, we want you to get us up on stage because we're big fans.
Stephanie has to hold on. Kurt, can you hold on a second?
What? Whoa. Get out. He is not. Yeah. Somebody doing an invitation, right? Kurt Russell?
I'm really, is this, who have I got?
Mark and Brian here, both of us.
This is him.
Is this Kurt?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Hi, Kurt.
Hey guys.
Kurt, yeah, we want to be you, Kurt.
How you doing?
Well, we're good, man. How are you?
I'm tired. I've been fighting a fire all night long.
Oh, have you really?
Oh yeah. I was up. I don't know. I guess about to, here. Turn that down because this is terrible hearing myself. Nothing worse than hearing yourself.
We're on delay.
Fighting the fire all night. I got the house saved, and about three neighbors. We're fighting three neighbors' houses, and we got that saved, too.
Jeez.
So it's been a long night. I'm on my way to work right now.
So your house is okay, then?
Saved, yeah. No, we got good. It saved. And I was driving along here, and I flipped around and found the station, and I heard you guys. So I thought I'd call and say hi.
Well, Kurt, first of all, you should know that we, you know, there ain't nothing funny going on here.
Huh?
The reason we say what we say is out of admiration for you as an individual. There ain't nothing, you know what I'm saying, we ain't, you know, after
you. Gotta be kidding. You should. Now listen, we never got our airplane ride.
No, we didn't. I noticed that.
So, I'm back in town now, and so I want to make that available to you.
Well, that would be great. In fact, okay. I left a special message on my machine there, Kurt, because I knew you'd be calling.
His laugh was great.
And I guess you're busy or something. So you say you're on your way to work.
Yes, where
are you working?
I'm doing a picture. I'm doing a picture called Stargate.
Is that going to be a good one?
I hope so.
Who's in there with you?
James Spader.
Ooh, there you
Ooh,
go.
Oh, God, he's good.
There you go.
Spader.
Science fiction or something?
Yeah, sci-fi.
Yeah.
It'd be a lot of fun. But listen, I want to make a deal with you.
All right.
Because my makeup man is in love with Nicole.
Has he met her?
He wants to take her out, and he said, if you'll call Mark and Brian, I'll bet that they would set me up with
you. Know it. In fact, today's Nicole's birthday, so this is the perfect birthday gift.
All right, Kurt, here's what we'll do.
Okay.
Notice that Nicole has nothing to say about this. We're making a deal here.
We're dealing in women.
That's right.
All right, Kurt, if you will come on the program, sit in our studio and talk into our microphone for like an hour, we'll talk about whatever, your makeup man can have Nicole.
Dennis Lydiard can have Nicole.
That's right.
Become his personal property to do as he wishes.
And we've said this on the air, so it's inked.
Yep.
Do I hear Nicole
hour,
laughing in the background?
Kurt, if like you stay in the studio for an hour, then I go out with him for an hour. So it's like if you hang with us for a long time.
But it's whatever he wants. It's whatever he wants. He might have been bad. You might want
to
spank it.
You know what I'm trying to figure out right now?
Yeah.
What do I get out of this?
Well, that was what we were just going to tell you, Kurt.
See,
Nicole will put out. We won't.
maybe Dana Delaney will call on the phone when I'm there.
There you go.
Okay, well, we'll have to work the hour out.
Hey, how's that Western? How's that
okay,
Western?
Okay, so that happened. You hung up. It went. That was hysterical, right? So he comes in a couple of weeks later, whatever. I went out with the makeup artist. It didn't hit it off. Nice guy and all, but it was not a thing. But Kurt still came on the show. And when he left, do you recall what happened?
No.
Okay. Well, good. This is fun because I get to see your face. So this is after Kurt left. He just left the studio.
Nicole, at the end of the Kurt Russell interview, we are in commercials. Switchboarder. This is unbeknownst. She had worked this out ahead
but
of time.
But I did
on the,
not.
Hang on. She must have worked this out ahead of time on the side. Switchboarder had a camera with her. So Nicole runs over to Kurt with the idea of just saying bye. I heard her say, let me go say bye.
Mm-hmm.
So she runs over, and it was just like this. Kurt standing by the door. Nicole runs over. Thank you for coming.
But I did not. Can I have my side and tell you what happened?
I'm feeling Sluggo, a red ass coming on.
Sluggo comes in here. Okay, during the interview, Sluggo, I guess, wanted a picture with Kurt. He goes, I have a camera here, so if you want, we can take pictures afterwards. Fine, okay. I was thinking take a picture with you guys, okay? I went over legitimately to say goodbye to Kurt. I hit the first commercial. I go over there. You guys are talking. I realize the commercial's running out. I come back around here to hit the next commercial, and they're just walking out the door, and I wanted to go say goodbye to him. I was going to go shake his hand, and it was a little kiss, and then Sluggo's there with the camera, so I turned around and took a picture, and that was it.
Done?
I had nothing to do with that.
Finished?
Yeah.
All right, this is what I saw. I saw you run up, take your left hand, put it behind his neck, and like try to pull him down to your lips.
Not.
And he was like, he had his hands on your shoulder trying to push you away, because, you know, it's not that he didn't like you, it's just that, you know, we're just met, and you're trying,
I was going to shake his hand, and it turned into like a kiss goodbye, but he was very nice.
Then you took your right leg and wrapped it around his, and you kind of tried to hunch him.
Well, yeah, I did that. Come on, you guys.
Photograph, tell you, it happened in a split second.
Sluggo, he's the one who wanted the picture. I didn't even ask.
Did Sluggo get a picture?
No.
Uh-huh. Who did
from here
a
picture from this studio?
But I didn't ask for it.
Hang on a second. Chuck, did you get a picture with Kurt Russell?
Not me.
Arlo, did you get one?
Not even close.
Brian, I know you and I didn't. Sluggo didn't. Nicole, did you get a picture with Kurt Russell?
Yeah, but I didn't ask for it. I just happened to be
just
there.
Hang on just a minute.
We from this studio.
Did anybody in this building get a picture with Kurt Russell?
I'll sell you one of mine if you want a copy.
We saw at least three separate shots at him.
Yeah,
where
you guys them at least a
you got him
of
once
times.
Behind that there, once, and once in the doorway,
what?
And once in the picture.
At least twice that I saw.
You're all
okay,
over
so
him.
That went on for probably another 10 minutes. You guys, you started in with, you got the red ass, you got the baboon ass, and just giving me all kinds of shit. And then
you deserved it.
Oh, I did not. Now. So, okay. So this is going on and on and on.
But, you know, we have to maintain a certain level of professionalism in here, Nicole.
I was being professional. I went over to shake his hand and say goodbye and thank you so much for coming in.
Yep.
That's not what happened. Sluggo's there with the camera. What am I going to say? No, I don't want a picture?
You know what I think is really funny about this?
What?
Is it Sluggo wanted the picture?
No.
It was Sluggo who wanted the picture.
She really thinks we're meaning all this.
Yeah. Well, the hotline's ringing.
Uh-oh, maybe Kurt.
Hello? It is Kurt.
Put him on.
Hold on.
Listen, Kurt, we apologize.
We're very, very sorry.
I'm on my way in the building, but I just wanted to say this to Nicole. Mm-hmm. In that situation,
uh-huh.
I've never had better. I gotta go.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, guys.
Hey, Kurt.
See you later.
I love that. That is certainly one of my, it's just the best. And yes, and I do, and I've got my picture with Kurt Russell. Oh, and by the way, one thing that I cut off the end because, you know, it's time consuming. But at the end of the thing, the first call, when you said, you know, good luck, stay safe in the house, he's like, oh, I was sleeping last night. I wasn't fighting any fires. I was kidding. Yeah.
Well, it's also a dichotomy of what the show was.
Exactly.
In that we seem to be able to have the ability to have people like Kurt Russell, like Tom Cruise, Anthony Hopkins, to do things that they wouldn't normally do. And I think a lot of that had to do with the fact that we were real people having a good normal human being time. We weren't out to make fun of them.
Nope.
We weren't out to embarrass them. And I think that they, all of them, picked up on that and were willing to play along because they understood it was innocent fun. You just heard Kurt having a good time, getting involved in us giving Nicole a hard time. And he jumped in and played. And that really was one of the things I felt was the essence of what we were.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, I wound up leaving because I was a AAA station. My music was coming on the air and it was, you know, I was ready. I was just ready. But, I left a huge part of my heart with you guys and remained there. And you guys kept going for another 20 some odd years, which is amazingly incredible. Just absolutely incredible. And I look back on my career. I look back on those 4 years and sometimes pinch myself and say, that was some of the best times of my life. I mean, truly, you couldn't make up stories like the ones we lived. And then you kept going with it. And you and Brian really deserved that induction into the Radio Hall of Fame. I'm just sorry I couldn't have been there to celebrate with you. Nobody was there to celebrate with you because it was COVID time.
Yeah, well, plus I thought that it kind of worked out because 2020 is, we were inducted October last year. Yeah. And 2020 was the 100th anniversary of the invention of the radio.
Right.
And the fact that the ceremony was on the radio, even though it was because of COVID, mm-hmm. I just felt like it fit.
Yeah.
In fact, I sat right here in the studio and did my induction speech. And I just felt like it fit.
Yeah. Okay. And I looked on the Radio Hall of Fame site because I wanted to get the little logo. I wound up not taking it, but they have class pictures from every year except for 2020. And then I thought, you know what? Glenn Beck was also inducted in 2020, and maybe you're better off not being in the room with him. But, it would be nice to have that. I don't know if they're planning on doing anything special for the class of 2020 at some point.
Well, they said that, if we do have a ceremony in 2021, we would like for the class of 2020 to come. I haven't heard anything about that, but I did call Bill Summers and tell
him, general
manager,
right?
Yeah. And said, he's the one that hired us at KLOS and made my goal of making Major Market come true. And I told him this many times. And I said, if we do go, I'm flying you and Joey in.
Nice.
I'm taking care of it. You will be there. You will sit at the table and you will be inducted along with us. And he said, I loved it. He said, Mark, I will go wherever you tell me to go. So if it does happen, he will be there sitting at the table and enjoy everything he deserves.
Awesome. Awesome. So now you're retired. You're living in North Carolina. You do a show. You have your own studio there. I love it. It's mnlstudios.com. When you were inducted into the Hall of Fame, you did a bunch of interviews. And I watched you with Sam Rubin, who was a friend of the show and was always good to me even after I left. And he said, and Mark is at mandelstudios.com.
I laughed at it too, yeah. Well, it is an odd thing to look at, mnlstudios.com. But I do the show once a week. I did schlep it where it was 5 days a week, and I just don't.
It's a grind. Let me tell you,
it is a grind, and I don't want that anymore. I've got grandkids coming. We're going to be traveling a lot more.
Awesome.
I've slowed it down, but I still do we did it this morning. I still have that one show a week where I get to talk into a microphone, and that gives me that need that I've got. You understand what I'm talking about?
I do.
I get it once a week, and that's plenty for me.
Right. And Linda gets to participate. You know, Linda was always part of the show. She was a family member and obviously a main family member. And we lived through, the birth of Katie and all, everything that comes with life, because it was, our lives were an open book. And so, and I think that's missing now. I don't think that exists anywhere on the radio.
I think it changed when radio itself changed. Yeah. And it, I'm sure it still exists in the world of podcasting or satellite or whatever the case may be. But it was, as you say, and I agree, it was a very, very special time to be living in Los Angeles and have a chance to be a part of that radio program. God knows I treasure and cherish those years, and you've been sharing these clips. It's some of the stuff I haven't ever heard.
Right. And you know what? As do I, Mark. And I really wanted to say it, publicly. I'd been in radio before I met you. I mean, that's one of the reasons why you took me on. In fact, I'll pat myself on the back and say that Jim Kerr, the day it was announced that you and Brian were in the class of 2020 to be inducted, Jim Kerr, who hosts mornings still today on Q104 in New York, I worked with producing Jim Kerr and the Morning Crew on WPLJ in New York before I moved out to LA. And he sent me an email that morning. And he said, I think you might be the only person who has produced two Radio Hall of Fame morning shows. So I'll take that. I'll take that,
absolutely.
And be very proud that I worked with both of you. And I learned something real from you guys. And that is, again, I had worked in news talk radio, had produced a big morning show. I had been a disc jockey, had done all that stuff. But what I learned from you, Mark, was that it's okay to be real, that this microphone is the best lie detector ever. And if you're bullshitting, They can tell. This picks it up immediately. And so the best thing you can do is be honest. Be who the fuck you are. And my listeners will tell you, they've seen me break down in a major depressive episode.
I've seen it too.
I know you have. They've seen me laugh uncontrollably. They've seen me cry because it's real. And that's why we connect. And that's what works. And I learned that. I really got that from you. So thank you.
Well, you're kind to say it, but it is true. I learned a long time ago after I'd had my light bulb moment, which was a game changer for me. I started doing radio. Basically, before that, I was doing radio that I thought listeners would want to hear. And after my light bulb moment, I realized the lesson that I learned was to do what I wanted to hear. And you accumulate like-minded people who enjoy your crap. And it was then that I realized being yourself, not only in life, but on the radio, it changed everything. It gave me what the gift is that I was given, which was don't care what other people think or say, do your deal. And if you mean it, people will know it.
Yes, I couldn't agree more. It's absolutely what it is. Again, this thing right here, it will ferret out every lie. You can tell when someone's bullshitting you. And that's a lesson that has been ingrained in me.
Very powerful.
Mark Thompson, I thank you so much for doing this. It's been a long time coming. We've been talking about doing it for a while. And I'm so glad. I'm glad I get to, you know, really thank you, because it was an epic time in my life. And when I'd say that you were my brothers, you know, after my father got hurt, I used to have this fantasy that eventually when I got married, you and Brian would walk me down the aisle, because you were seriously, we spent more time together than most married couples do. And it was for those 4 years, that was my life. And I loved almost every minute of it. Almost every minute.
Yeah, you know, I mean, that is also the bottom line, the truth being, yeah, we had some wonderful years and most of it was great, but it's still hard work.
Yeah.
The bottom line is to put on that kind of a show at the level that we did it. We worked. In fact, I'll sum it up this way. We got a listener, a guy who called, and he goes, so do you guys have like a job in the afternoon? And I cracked up because, see, this guy was listening to us have this wonderful, fun time.
Right.
And he couldn't imagine that we were paid to do that. We did that for fun in his mind. We had a real job in the afternoon, which is a compliment, quite frankly. But we spent 24/7 preparing many, 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 many hours for 4 hours that we spend on the air. And to do that, not only is it a blast, but it will tear you down and beat you. When you don't think you can go any further, you do, and you do it for the show. So yes, it was great and horrible.
Mark, you've not met him yet, but my husband, David, is here. He wants to, you can bend down so he can see, or he's not going to see you.
He's not going to see me.
Okay.
Well, hello, David.
How you doing, Mark?
I'm good, man. How are you?
I'm pleased to meet the other man in Nicole's life. So my former best friend, long story, lives in California. And Nicole and I were out there several years ago, and we got together with him and a couple of other buddies of mine who I knew from college at Arizona State. And we had dinner at this restaurant, and they brought their respective spouses or girlfriends, and none of them had met Nicole. All of them knew me. None of them had met Nicole. And Nicole, surprisingly, for someone who has a large personality on air, is really pretty quiet in most social situations. So we're sitting there at the dinner table, and you know, after several glasses of wine, someone says to Nicole, well, you know, what do you do? And she said, well, I'm on the radio. And she said, and they said, oh, really? You know, how did that all happen? And she said, well, I lived in LA for 15 years or whatever it was. And I used to be on you might have heard of the Mark and Brian show. And my former best friend's significant other at the time goes, you were Nicole? like she wasn't Nicole any longer because she wasn't on the Mark and Brian show. You were Nicole? And her jaw just dropped. I'm telling you, it was like an out-of-body experience for this woman that she was meeting Nicole from the Mark and Brian show, but she wasn't Nicole anymore because she was no longer attached at the hip to you two jokers.
Yeah.
So instead,
well,
now,
she still is Nicole. I can promise you that.
Oh, tell me now. Tell me about it. Now she's attached at the hip to me, and I'm the luckiest guy on the planet. But
good for
nice
you,
to
man.
Meet
good
you. I hope
good
our
to meet you.
I hope our paths cross someday, and we can swap lies.
That'd be great.
We will do that one of these days, one of these years. And you know what? One last thing I got to say that I realized, you know, these days I'm all news and politics and stuff. In the 4 years I worked with you guys, we never once talked politics. We did go see Bill Clinton on the beach in San Diego. I don't know if you remember this one.
Of course.
He was running. He wasn't even president yet. And he was doing a stop in San Diego near the Hotel Del Coronado. And some listener invited us and let us use their house on the beach. And Bill Clinton would go running down the beach every morning at the same time. And we went out there and ran alongside him with your mobile phone thing. And Dee Dee Myers, who wound up being his press secretary, you knew from Alabama, and she was a fan, and she helped us with this stuff. But that, aside from that, we never talked politics. I, to this day, don't know what your politics are. I have no idea.
The rule of thumb was, and I think probably still is for some entertainment-based radio,
uh-huh.
Is that religion and politics is a defining rod.
Right.
You know, you're talking to Republicans and Democrats and independents, and for you to step out there, especially in an entertainment forum,
right,
and say, this is the way I feel.
Right. It was not the right forum for it. Absolutely not.
Well, I mean, the rule of thumb is that you're offending half your audience.
Of course.
So why chance it? And so I'm not the most knowledgeable. Obviously, I know how I feel, but it really has nothing to do with what I was doing, which was trying to bring a smile to people. And I'll end on this note. Because it was such a great moment. I got into radio because I just wanted to be as good as I could, tell jokes, maybe make people smile as they traveled to work for their hour and a half, 2 hours in Los
in
Angeles
LA,
traffic.
Yep.
And I did that, and it was wonderful. And we made an appearance at the Orange County Fair, where it's one of the finest fairs I've ever been a part of. It's so well run, and we would have thousands of people that would come and stand in line to get our autograph or take a picture. And as it would sometimes happen, this entire family came up, a father and a mother and three beautiful little kids, and they were all dressed perfectly, which is always the mom. She dressed everybody, including the husband. And the mom and the kids did all the talking. The dad stood behind and just smiled. And his wife leaned over and said, he's a huge fan. He's just shy.
Uh-huh.
And he didn't say a word to us. And we signed their thing and off they went. And the event was over and I was walking to my car and I was approached by this very shy dad who didn't say anything. Behind him was his wife and his kids, but they were standing in the back. And there was a somber look on the wife's face that I didn't see at the fair. And I looked at the dad, and he was in the beginning of a level of emotion. And I was smiling at that point, and I stopped because I realized there was something that he wanted to say. And so I just went silent. And he said, I have listened to you guys since the day you came on the air, and I've loved every moment of it. Last year, my mother got cancer, and every day I would drive to the hospital, and I would brush the skin on her head where her hair used to be, hold her hand when she got her chemo injection, and I lost her in that year. But I wanted you to know that throughout that period, the toughest time in my entire life, the only smile that I got was you guys.
Mm.
And I welled up and hugged him and then walked to my car And it was in that moment. And I heard that same kind of thing a couple of times after that. Yep. I just got into this to be entertaining and tell jokes. I didn't know that what we do for a living and what we do because we love it could actually help somebody in a time that they needed it. And that I drove home that day and I honestly grew up a little in another kind of weird, wacky. I became another guy. So it's been my pleasure to be a part of this wonderful journey and to have you as a part of it, Nicole, and for you to have me on today. It means the world.
It means the world to me too. Mark, I love you. You'll always be part of my life. And I look back on that time. I can't believe it's been 30 years. I mean, 30 years ago we were in that studio together, and it seems like a minute ago. It goes by so quickly.
It was great.
And I'm very thankful that you're still in my life.
Thank you, sweetie. Good to be in your life. Glad you're in mine. The best to you.
Me too. Send my love to Linda, please, and the kids.
I will.
And hopefully we'll talk again soon.
I'll see you.
All right. Take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Mark Thompson. Wow. All right. Now I'm going to go have a weekend and keep going down memory lane because I'm stuck there. But wow. Great memories. And thank you for sharing it with me. All right. Bye, everyone. I'll see you Monday. Have a wonderful weekend.